Welcome back to the Introduction on Python and Programming course. This is chapter 6, which talks about bytes and text. So text we have seen before in as early as in chapter 1, and we know that it is modeled with the string type. So what are bytes? Bytes is the underlying representation of text. So this is how text is modeled with ones and zeros in memory. We will look into this towards the end of the chapter today. Because it is quite a generic data type to know bytes, and it's the one format in which you can basically transfer any data over a network, for example. So let's start simple with the string type. So how do we take how do we create strings? Well, we create strings by writing the text we want it to model between double quotes here. And let me execute this cell. So what this does in memory, it goes ahead and it creates a box that is rather big and will put the text lorem ipsum and so on in it. We know already that it has a tag, which is the str type, the star type or string type. And then after this object is created in memory, a new name is created, which is called a text, and this name references the object in memory. So how do we know that it is an object? Well, everything in Python is an object, and it has, as such, three properties, which means it has an identity, it has a type, and of course a value. Now, I already mentioned briefly that we write text with double quotes. But if I look at the value of the text variable here, it's given out to me in single quotes. So why is that? Let's look at some other example here. So here we have a text that models a quote by Albert Einstein. And it says, Albert Einstein said, if you can't explain it, you don't understand it. So what do we see here? Well, because it is a quote, it does contain quotation marks as well. However, because we use the double quotes as the literal that limits where the text information starts and where it ends, we cannot use the double quote in the text itself. So what we do instead is we have to escape it. So escaping means that we put a backslash here, and the backslash implies to Python that the following character, in this case a double quote, is not to be interpreted as the limit, as the delimiter here, but instead as the character double quote itself. So if I execute this code cell, I get back a text string which says, Einstein said, and then we have a double quote here. So it works. But wait a minute, what do we see here? We're given out the text string with enclosing single quotes here, right? And now, because we have the English word can't and don't in it, with the abbreviation of the single quote here, now the single quote must be escaped. And Python does that for us by putting the backslash before the single quote here. So you may wonder, why do I write the string with a double quote and Python gives it back to me with a single quote? Well, this is just the default that Python does. In fact, both the double quote and a single quote, they are perfect substitutes. So if I execute the next code cell where I just switched the double and the single quotes, what I see is it also works. And now I get back the string in the exact same way as I defined it. And so it both is equivalent here, right? And so for me, I use the convention that I use preferably double quotes around the string. This has various reasons. One reason is that, for example, I use some code formatting tool, which is called Black, and it's very popular at the moment. So you can just search on the internet for Python and Black, and then you should already find this tool. And what the tool does is I write code, and I give it my code, and then the code gets back and formatted in one unique way. So if if I, for example, make two spaces instead of four for indentation, then the code that I get back from this formatting tool will have four spaces. So it has, there is one way to format the code. This is why the tool is called Black, because Henry Ford said you can have the car in any color as long as it's black. That's a famous quote that is attributed to the founder of the Ford company. And because of that, what he implies is that in order to be efficient in his production, in the facilities at Ford, you don't want to have too much variety in the cars. And this is why Ford back then chose that you can have the car in any color as long as it's black. And in the same analogy here, I can write code in any way I want, but the formatting tool gives me back the code in a unique way. And the Black tool is one of the most popular tools out there at the moment. And the Black tool defaults to double quotes. And that's just the convention. And also, I've seen the double quote convention being used on many software projects. And in particular, the reasoning goes like this, because usually software uses English-speaking text predominantly. And in English language, we have the single quote a lot. We just use the double quote as a delimiter so that we don't have to escape all the single quotes. However, that is a bad argument, because you could also make the argument that in any text, you are most likely at some point going to use a double quotation mark as well. And so this you could also make the counter argument here. In other words, this is an example of where a programmer may have a very strong opinion, but you cannot really justify this opinion with an argument. And so syntactically, both of the cells that you see here, they are perfectly equivalent. They are perfect substitutes of each other. And Python defaults to this notation. We just have to get used to it. The developers of Core Python, they just had to make a choice, and they choose the latter here. And in this book, however, I prefer to use double quote notation. The double quote notation has also one big advantage. You cannot confuse, if you know that your code base only uses double quotes, you cannot confuse one double quote with two single quotes. And two single quotes would, of course, imply a string with no characters inside. So a string with no characters inside in the double quote notation is a lot easier to spot because it's clearer. However, again, this is an argument that you can hold against me because it's actually not a good argument. It's just a convention here. However, if no matter which of two strings we use, if we print it out with the built-in print function, we just see that the sentence is printed as we would expect it to, and both the single quotes and also the double quotes are not escaped, so the text appears on screen as we want it to. And also, just to reiterate an important point, the first two code cells, they are expressions that evaluate to a text string. So they evaluate to a text string just like lorem ipsum did here. And then because we don't capture it in a variable, we get it back as output. That's why we see out here and out here. And the print function processes the object that gets evaluated. And because of that, it does not return us a value. The print function has no return value, at least not an explicit one. The print function only has a side effect, and because of that, we can see the side effect here. The text is printed to screen, but I don't see the output here. So that's just a minor grammatical observation here. So how else can we take how else can we create text strings? Well, we can use the str built-in constructor. That's a built-in callable. And just like we saw the int and the float constructor in the chapter 5, now we have the str constructor here. And for example, I can pass it an integer 42, and I get back text data, a text string with the value 42. The same goes for floats. The same goes, interestingly, for list. And the same goes for booleans as well. And it would also work for none. So if I replace true here with the none type, it also works. So this has to do with the fact, as we shall see in chapter 10, that any object should have what is called a text representation. So we have seen that integers have a so-called binary representation. We saw that in chapter 5. These are the zeros and ones that are in the box that make up the value of the integer. And the same holds true also for floats. Floats also have a binary representation. Anything should have a binary representation at the end of the day, because a computer can only model zeros and ones. But We also saw that it's kind of tedious to always write out all the zeros and ones if we are interested in how something is represented in memory. And because of that, some other representations exist, most notably one that we also saw in the previous chapter, the hexadecimal notation, which is basically a number that instead of just 10 using just 10 digits that we use as humans in the way we count, it uses 16 digits from 0 to 9 and then from A through F. And on top of the hexadecimal representation, there is yet another representation, and this is what we will call the text representation. And the text representation will become a bit clearer in chapter 10. But for now, just note that basically any object in Python can or should be represented in text somehow. How else can we get text strings? Well, we can use the built-in input function, which takes input from a user. And the input function takes a string itself as the argument. And what it does is it uses this text to prompt the user with it. So if I execute the cell, I see the exact same message here that I entered here as a text string, and now I can enter anything I want. For example, I am text, enter it. And now if I go ahead and check what is the type of the variable user input here, or the type of the object to which user input references, it's of type str, string. And the value of user input is, of course, I am text. And note that the input function returns text no matter what. So even if I just enter nothing, I still have a str type here, and I still have a text string output here, but now the value is the empty string, so a string that contains no characters. So we saw input before in chapter 4 in the section on indefinite loops. And there was an example on guessing a coin toss. And in this function, we used it. And we used it to ask the user if he wants to guess heads or tails. But if we, and heads or tails are, of course, text strings as well. But if we want to use input, for example, to obtain an integer from a user, we could do that as well. And how would we do that? For example, we would change it a bit. We would say enter a number. And then we would wrap the input function with the built-in int constructor, execute it again. And now let's say I write the number 10. And now the type of user input is int, and user input is now the integer 10. So I can adapt the input function by wrapping it a bit, but by default, the input function always returns text. Another way of creating text strings is by reading in files. So I give you an example. In the project folder, you will find a file called lorem-ipsum.txt. And I have opened this file here in the Sublime text text editor, and it's just dummy text at the end of the day. So, and it consists, as we see, of 7 lines of text here, and the last line is empty. And before that, we have 6 lines with just dummy text. So, how can we read in this? This data file into Python? Well, there is the open built-in, and we just call open with a text string in it, which is the path to the file. And because I opened Jupyter Notebook in the project folder, I don't have to specify a location. I can just specify the name of the file. And whatever is returned from open will be stored in a variable called file. So let's do that. And now the question is, what is a file? So let's check what is file. Let's ask Python, what is the type? And Python tells me it's a text I/O wrapper. And that is weird in, for now, because I told you that it's a text file. And when we open a text file, we expect that we read in text, right? So what is file, really? If I check the value of file, we see that still it's a text I/O wrapper. That's the type. And then we say it says the name of the file is lorem-ipsum.txt, mode is R, okay, and the encoding is something called UTF-8. So we have to understand a little bit more here. So first of all, what does the mode R mean? Mode R means we open the file in read-only mode. So I can now look at the text inside the file, but I cannot change it. And the encoding, I will explain towards the end of the chapter today what that is. So we can, of course, use methods or on the file object or attributes to check certain things. For example, I can call the method readable, and what readable returns is a true or false. And it basically answers the question, can I only read this file or am I allowed to write? And because it's a read-only file, readable returns true. And then there's also writable, the writable method, and it returns false. That's another way of checking that, can I only read the file or can I also write into this file? There's an attribute called name. And so I can also access the name as a text string itself on the file object by saying file.name. And lastly, of course, I can also get the encoding of the file, which again we saw is UTF-8 and will be explained later. So the file object can do a whole lot. But let's see what the file object really is. So what happened in Python in memory is an object was created, and there's the object can do something, but we don't really know what it can do. So let me for now just write lorem underscore ipsum dot text here. That's the path to the file. And this is of type file of text IO wrapper. So let me just abbreviate it with text IO. And then this was stored in a variable called called file. So let's create file and make it reference the object. So that is what happened in memory. Now the question is, where is all the text that is in the file, right? How can we access it? And the thing is this, by default, you should think of file objects like this. This file object here, it acts as a so-called proxy, a proxy to the outside world in a way. So what I would do, how I think of it is, I think of it as this. Let me maybe draw a border here. Okay. And on the left-hand side, this here is Python, the Python process or Python world, so to say. And on the right-hand side, I just write OS. For operating system. So this can be, in my case, it's a Linux system. In your case, it's probably a Mac or a Windows system. And operating systems, when you start, for example, Python, what the operating system does is it reserves a certain area in memory and gives it to this Python process and says, well, within this memory space, you can do whatever you want, Python. And this is the space that so far we have used as you know, a small part, which is a list of all the names, and then the bigger part of memory where we have all the objects in memory. However, that doesn't mean that this is the entire memory of our machine. In fact, that the OS uses a lot more. And in particular, what the OS also does is it provides access to the files on disk. So in a way, I think of it like this. There is a file. Draw it maybe. Let's maybe zoom out a little bit first. Okay, let's draw the file like this. There's a text data here, somehow like this. And this is somewhere on disk. We don't know where it is, so it's definitely not in Python. And then what Python does when we open the file, what we get is we get, maybe I use a different color here, I use green. I get kind of like a tunnel, so to say, to the outside world. So somehow the text object can look outside the Python memory and it can look on the disk, and it looks right now at the beginning of the file here. Basically, it looks at the first character in the file. So now what I can do in Python, when I want to get to the contents of a text file, I can just loop over the file object. So I write here for line in file. So I'm looping over file. And then I just print out every line. Let's execute this. And here it is. Here is all the contents of the file that I just opened in another text editor as well. Okay, so note that we saw before in chapter 4, we used the technical term of an iterable. And an iterable, I told you, is anything that can be looped over. In that sense, a file object is also an iterable, right? We can loop over it. So now, why does Python do that? Well, first of all, imagine you easily can have files on disk that are larger than your computer's memory, your working memory. So in other words, if when you opened a file, if you would copy all the contents of the file immediately into memory, there is a risk that your computer may die because it goes out of memory. So in other words, it is a smart decision here by Python to just give you back a so-called proxy object with which you can look outside, and then you can choose as the programmer of how this how you use the proxy object. And what I did here is I looped over the file. So in a way, I started here at the first line, and then in the second iteration of the loop, I'm reading the second line, and in the third iteration, the third line, and so on until I hit the end. And then what happens? Well, what happens is, if I, for example, execute the for loop again, I don't get any output. And that's interesting. And the reason for that is because after the first time around where I read the file, what happened is this thing through which I see the file, it moved down one line by one, and it ended up here. So at the end of the day, I'm not here anymore, but now my file proxy object is looking through this tunnel to the last line, actually beyond the last line, to the last, it's to the right of the last character in the last line. So if I now run the for loop again and again, no matter how often I run it, I don't see any more contents, because what the file proxy object tries to do is it tries to continue to read in the file. However, there is nothing to be continued, which is why I don't see any output. Okay. And nevertheless, we have also learned that after a for loop is over, the target variable over which is set in every iteration of the loop still exists after that. So what is line? So line is still set to the last line in the file, obviously. And what is line? If I ask Python what is the type of line, it is of type str. So by reading, by looping over a file object, I can create a string objects as well, naturally in a way. So now the question is, what can we do with this file object if we are at the end of the file? Well, first, we could, and I will not show this here, but we could, of course, tell the file proxy to move this tunnel back to the top and start reading again. We could do this, but usually we don't need to do this or don't want to do this. And then also note that as long as this tunnel here exists, we say that the file object is still open. So the file object comes with an attribute called closed. So if I execute here file.closed, I get as the return value false. And that means the file is still open. So the tunnel is still alive. The question is, why is that good or bad? Or what's the implication of that? Well, in the way operating systems work, the number of open file handles, of tunnels from one process to the operating system, is limited. And it's limited to an actually rather low number. So I think many operating systems, they can just have at most around 1,000 files open at once. And that's just that's a low number. So whatever we should do after we are done reading a file, we should, of course, close it. And how do we do that? We call the close method on the file object. And if I now ask Python, is the file still closed? Or is it closed? And then Python says, yes, it is closed. So what the close method does by calling it, the tunnel here gets removed. And now the file is closed. And if I now tried to read the file object again, let's go back to the for loop. If I now try to loop over the file object again, I would actually get a value error here because it says I'm doing a I/O operation. I/O means input output. An I/O operation on a closed file, and that's of course not possible. So the file proxy is now closed. We try to read the file, but we cannot read it because we closed it. Okay, and the thing is, because I just told you that you always should close a file, there is a better way to do that in Python code. We can use the open built-in in a, what is called a context manager. So how does what is a context manager? In other words, it's called the with statement. So we have a header line here. It starts with, and then we have the open and the path of the file, and then we say f file colon, and then we indent the for loop by four spaces here. And what this means is, this code here, the for loop, is executed within the context of this context manager. And the context manager is created by the open function. So in other words, open returns a file object, which we saw here, which is of type text.io wrapper. And a text.io wrapper object can act as a so-called context manager. And whenever an object can act as a so-called context manager, we may write it within, or we may use it within the with statement. And that is just to executing code within the context of something. And what does the context manager do? So first, I execute this code cell, and the file gets opened a second time. So what really happens here is, because I'm using the file variable again, what would actually happen in memory is we create a new text.io object. I don't do this here now, but we would create a new text.io object somewhere else in memory. And then we would make the file name here, the file variable name, reference the new object. And then we would remove the old object, right? Just as we do with objects all the time. And then what the with context manager here does, it automatically closes the file. So after we leave the context of the context manager here, the file is automatically closed. And we can check that by asking the file if it's closed, and the file object confirms to me, yes, I'm closed. So this is a nice feature by Python, and you will see many context managers in many different contexts, so to speak. And the context manager that comes with a file object is just one example of it. And in that way, they usually help us to ensure that some... So usually a context manager has two jobs. The first job is to set up something before something is done, and then to tear down something after something ended. So the setup doesn't really happen here, because a setup, we just have to open a file. This is already happening when we call open here. But then for the teardown that happens at the end, the context manager basically calls the close method on the file object automatically. That's all it does. And it would even close the file if I ran into an error here, right? So if I, for example, write 1/0 here, which will create a zero division error. Let's do this. I get a zero division error. Then the file object is closed. So even if an exception occurs within the context manager, so within this code block, the context manager accepts for this exception, so it catches it. And then it closes the file, and then it re-raises the exception so that we see the exception at the end of the day. But even though we saw an exception, the file is still closed. And that's a good thing. That's what we want. So that means, as a best practice, if you want to read in files, do it with the with statement. So of course, instead of looping over a file object, what we can also do is this. Here, I create a new file object. I open a file. I can also use, for example, the read method. And the read method on the file object takes an integer argument. So I say 11. And what that means is it basically says to Python, give me the first 11 characters in the file. So let's execute this. And this is just lorem ipsum. And now if I call this method again, so what happens then is I get the next 11 characters. So this is like the tunnel that we saw here. The tunnel is now not moving on a line-by-line basis, but the tunnel is now moving a certain number of characters. And if there is a new line or not, we don't care. So new lines get basically ignored. We just move along the characters in increments of 11 in this case. And then, of course, there's a read line method. And what the read line method does, it continues to read from where we left off until it hits a new line. So what we see here is I just get the remaining first line, right? So maybe I compare this with the original file. So the first 11 characters are here, the next 11 characters are here, and then the read line method just showed me the end of the first line. That's what I'm seeing here. And if I run the read line method again, I just get the next line, the second line in this case. And then there is one more method, which is called read lines, so plural. And what this does is it gives me back all the remaining lines in a list object. So now I have a list object that contains all the remaining lines. And then, of course, because we opened the file and now we know we should close it, I just close it here manually. So this was just to show you that there are alternatives to looping over a file. Looping is maybe the nicest way. So if you know ahead of time that you want to do something with every line in a file, then just use a for loop. But if you need to process a file in a different way, then it is maybe better to do it with the read method or the read line or the read lines method, depending on what the goal of your program is. Okay. So these were all the ways, or these were the most common ways of how we can create strings in Python. And now let's analyze a little bit what a string is. So first of all, why is it a string called a string? Well, string is just a formal word that exists for historic reasons. And the more modern word, which means exactly the same in computer science, would be a sequence. So string and sequence are synonyms. But as I said, for historic reasons, when we talk about text data, we usually talk about strings. And so how should we think of text? I have here written the headline, a string of characters. And this is really how we should view a text. So so text is nothing but a sequence. And we will learn in the next couple of chapters, in chapter 7 in particular, what a sequence is. But we should view text not as a text as a whole, which, of course, we should always interpret text as a whole. But it's more important to also see the individual characters in a text. So it's a text is something that is made up of individual characters. That's the view we should have. So here is our example text from the beginning, lorem ipsum. And now I told you it's a string of characters. And I also told you that a string is more formally known as a sequence. And now why do I use the term sequence? So sequence means a text has four properties. The first property is the text has to be finite. Any sequence must be finite. So if I call the len function and pass it text, I get back 27, because 27 is the number of characters in the text. So we saw len before, but when we used len before, we called it with a list object passed in. So we used it, for example, to calculate the length or the number of element in the list numbers in the first chapter, for example. And so what we see here is that the len function accepts a list, but it also accepts a string. So what is the type that the len function really takes? And the answer is, we see here duck typing as an example. That's an application of duck typing here. And duck typing means we don't really care what type of object we pass in. We care more about how the object we pass in behaves. And in one way, namely in the way of being finite or infinite, both a list object and a string object behave in the same way. They are both finite. So they have something in common here, and because they know the concept of length, that's basically the idea, the abstract idea behind, and because they do know both the same concept, in this regard, they both work with the len function. Another thing, what we can do with text, we can loop over it. And in chapter 4, I told you that anything we can loop over is a so-called iterable, and because of that, a text string itself is an iterable. So what I do here is I just print the individual characters in a text, and I put some more spaces in between them. And note that as I loop over text, in every iteration of the loop, I get exactly one character back. So this is what I meant when I said that we should view text as a string of characters. So it's the characters that really make up the text, the text string. And because of that, looping occurs in iterations of individual characters. And then that's the second property. The first one being length, knowing the concept of length. The second being an iterable. The third property is that sequences and strings can be or are ordered. And how do I see the order in the text string? Well, whenever I loop over the text here, I see it occurs in obviously the same order as I define the text. This seems to be trivial, but it's an important fact. And then whenever something is in order, what that means is I can also loop in backward order. So maybe you find the word reversed, or the more technical term here, reversibility, to be a bit surprising. But in order for something to be reversible, it has to have a forward order to begin with. Otherwise, we couldn't reverse something. So when I say I can loop over text in reversed order, that basically means we have an order. So that's the third property of a string, that it's ordered. And then there's the fourth property. And we saw this before in chapter 4. When I talked about iterables, I made a distinction between iterables and containers. And containers are any data type that basically contains or consists of other objects. So in this case, a text string, as I said, consists of individual characters. And how can we check if an individual character is contained in a text? Well, I can use the in operator. So I can, for example, ask, is the letter uppercase L in the text, and I get back true. So that's a Boolean expression at the end of the day. It evaluates to either true or false. And then I can also say, is, for example, the word ipsum in text, and I also get back a true. So I cannot only check if individual characters are contained in a text, but I can also check if so-called substrings are contained in a bigger string. And but the property that I want to emphasize here is the container property. So text contains other things. So that's why. And then of course I can check some random text, veni, vidi, vici, which Julius Caesar said famously. And this is of course not contained in the text we are given, which is why I get back a false. So just to summarize, what is a string? A string is another word for sequence, and a sequence is any data type that has the following four properties. The first property is it knows the concept of length. We can check that with the len function. The second concept is we can iterate over it. It's an iterable. We saw that with the first for loop. The third property of a sequence is it must be ordered. And we saw that basically also with the for loop, because we see that the characters, we obtain them one by one in a forward order. But we can always check if something is ordered by passing it to the reversed built-in. And then we can loop in backward order or in reverse order. And whenever we can go over something in a reverse order, we know it must have a forward order, because otherwise we couldn't have a reverse order. And then the fourth property, again, is here. It's the container property. So that means a sequence is always something that contains other things, other objects most of the time. So these are the four properties. These are absolutely worthwhile to know, and because everything that fulfills those four properties is considered a sequence. And whenever something is considered a sequence, then many nice things follow from that. So, for example, because strings are sequences, we can exploit some of the four properties that I just mentioned. So, for example, I can index into a string. We saw indexing before with lists, and we saw that we have to index with zero-based indices. So if I want to obtain the first character in text, I index with the number zero, and I get back the uppercase L. So indexing only works because I have an order, because otherwise, if the sequence were not ordered, how would I know what is the first letter? And you now may wonder, so far you haven't seen anything that is unordered. Let me tell you that just because we haven't seen this, that means it doesn't exist. In chapter 8, when we talk about mappings and sets, we will see a data type, namely the set type, that behaves in many ways like a list type, but is unordered. Now you may ask the question, why would I ever use something that is unordered if I can use something else that is ordered? Well, the we will see then that by giving up order, some optimizations can be done in memory, which makes some operations faster. So it's always there's always a trade-off here. So order is really something that sometimes we really need in a program, but sometimes we don't need it. And when we don't need it, we may want to use a data type that is not ordered. However, the string data type is ordered, and because it's ordered, we can index. But without order, we couldn't index because we wouldn't know what is the first element to begin with. And the second property here, let's first look at some other examples. So let's get the second character. We index with one. And now comes the, let's get to the end of the string. If I want to obtain the last element in a string, I have to index with the len of the sequence, len of text here, minus one. And we saw that text has a length of 27. So now to obtain the last character, I index with the number 26. And I get back the dot at the end. What I must not do, or what will not work, is I cannot index with 27, which would be the length of the text. This will raise an index error because we are obviously one index too high. And so there is a second property in use behind the scenes, which is the property of the string being finite. Because only if something is finite can we index from the right-hand side, from the end. And how can we index from the end? Well, what we can do, I make this a little bit smaller for now. So here we see lorem ipsum, the string again, in a table. And we see the indexes of the individual characters in the uppermost row. And then we see in the middle row the reverse indices. And we see that the last character, the dot, has an index of 26. But it also has an index of negative one. And this only works because the string data type is finite. And what that means is I can, to get the last character, I can index with just negative one instead of 26. So I will zoom in a little bit again. And now we don't see all the numbers here, but it's not so important. You get the idea. And so we can also index from the right-hand side. And this, again, only works because of the finiteness. So to get the first letter, I can also index, for example, with the negative 27, I am back at L. And why is that useful to have? Well, sometimes when you read in data, let's say numerical data in a list or textual data in a string, then maybe you only know the relative position of something. So if you know that whatever you are looking for is in the, you know, 10th position from the end, then maybe you want to index with negative 10, and maybe you don't know how long the text will be. So by allowing negative indices, we can always index from the end without even knowing how long the actual data string will be. And this enables a nicer way of working with sequence data. And then let's generalize indexing a bit. And this is called slicing. So what is slicing? Slicing means that out of a longer string, we get a shorter one. For example, if I want to extract the first five letters from the text string, I do that by saying text, and then I use the index operator, and instead of passing in a single integer, I pass in two integers separated by a colon. So this means, get me the letters, the characters, from the first one to the fifth one. However, as we saw with, for example, the range built-in before, the left index, the zero, is included in the result, and the right index won't be included. So we get back the first word, lorem. And why is the five not included? Well, this has many, many reasons, but one nice property of the right of the upper index not being included is that when I calculate the difference of the right minus the left, so 5 minus 0, which is 5, I know the length of the resulting text string. Of course, I could also index from somewhere in the middle to the end. How would I do that? Well, as I know that the right index is not included, I will index in this case from the 12th character or the 13th character, really, from the 12th index to the length of the text. And length of the text we know is one too high for indexing to work, but because the right-hand side is not included in the index, this still works. So now I get back the second half of the sentence, which just says, dolor sit amet, and we also see the dot, so the last character is indeed included. Okay, so whenever we start an index with zero, or we have the upper index being the length of the string, what we can also do is we can also just leave it out. So colon 5 just means take the first five characters of the string. And in other words, the default index, if omitted, is just zero. In the same way, if the upper index is the length of the string, then we can also omit it. And basically here, 12 colon means start at the 13th character and give me the string until the end. So get back the same result here. And again, once you start working with textual data or sequence data, again, you may not know how long a text string is. For example, think of you load in user input with the help of the input function, and you don't know how long what the user will type in and how long it is. So if you only want to, let's say, look at the first five characters that a user entered, then you just type this. Or if you just want to look at the end of what the user entered, you just want to look at this. And then your code is kind of like independent of how long the string actually is. So the way you should, these are equivalents here. But again, in a real world program, leaving out indices can actually be like an added feature, because that means we don't have to know how long a string is. So it enables a nicer way of working with data. And then, of course, we can combine positive and negative indices. And let's say we go from the 6 index to the negative 10 index to get ipsum dolor. And again, also here, whenever you see the first index being a positive number and the second index being a negative number, there is a nicer way to interpret this. This just means throw away the first 6 characters and throw away the last 10 characters and keep everything in the middle. So at the end of the day, we cannot calculate the length of the result by just subtracting the right-hand side minus the left-hand side. This only works if both indices are positive. But if one of them is negative, what we can do is we can have a relative, a relative view on text data. And then one thing that you see often in code is we just write colon. And what colon does, we can already predict it. The left index will be zero, the right index will be the length of text, because these are the default indices. So we will get back the entire string. So now you may wonder, why would I ever do that? Well, this is usually done to get a copy. So in other words, when you want to create a second object for whatever reason, then you will use the colon operator to take the so-called full slice, and then you get back a copy of the entire text. This is not so important for text data, actually, but as we will see in chapter 7 on numerical sequences, this will become very important. And also when we work with array data and data frames in chapter 9, this will be even more important, because then, you know, one goal of my course is to prepare you to work with big amounts of data. And whenever we talk about big data, that means that we are necessarily constrained with our memory, with our computer's memory. So you may end up being in a situation where 80% of your computer's memory is occupied by only one matrix, for example, and it's not possible to get a copy. And in this situation, you have to really know what your code does. And just writing a colon in the index operator will give you a full copy. And sometimes this is not what you want. So I just want to illustrate it here, that you already know what this means, the colon notation. And then, besides having a start and stop index, we can also have a third index, which we will call the step size. And this basically means we can control if we want every element, or in this case, in the example, if we want to only take every other character. So here, what this means is I take a slice from the beginning to the end, and I only take every other character. So I get back only every second character. Sometimes this is useful if you want to downsample your data. But then the assumption is that whatever your data is in the text string is kind of like, you know, only distributed by random chance in a way. And, you know, what I'm saying may not be intuitive with text data, but again, just notice that texts are sequences. And whenever the sequences contain, let's say, numerical data, all the operators that I'm presenting here, they also work exactly in the same way. And then maybe these applications really work. And then, of course, we can reverse the order by having a negative step size. So this will just turn the string around. And yeah, so this is that's indexing, that's and slicing. Okay, one note that I also said a little bit about the numbers in the last chapter. At least you will find it in the text. Numbers in chapter 5, but also text here in chapter 6, has one property, which is called the immutability. So what that means is, after you have created an object in memory, you cannot change it. So we said that an object is a box with zeros and ones in it, and for some boxes, as we have seen, we can actually change the box after we created it, and some other boxes we cannot change after we created it. And one box that we actually did change after we created it was a list. So in lists, remember in chapter 1 it was already, where I you know, where I replaced one element in the list. So a list objects are obviously not immutable, but text strings will be immutable. So what does that mean? So what that means is, practically, I cannot assign to an index. So I cannot go ahead and replace the first letter in the lorem ipsum text here. So if I do that, I get a type error. And it says the string object does not support item assignment. I cannot assign to strings. And also, I cannot assign to slices. So that's, again, just to say that once the lorem ipsum is created, we cannot replace any characters. Once it's there, the only thing we can really do is we can make a new string where we change some of the characters, but then again, we will have a new string, a second string object. Okay, so now let's look at what are typical behaviors that we require a text string to have, and the behaviors manifest themselves in the string methods. So methods are the functions that are bound to the objects, and for text data, there are some very specific methods bound to it. So for example, I have my lorem ipsum text here, and let's say I want to find or search for some letter in there. Let's say I want to search for the letter A. And so I just say text.find, and then I pass in the character A, and I get back a 22. And what is 22? Well, 22 is just the index at which the first time Python finds the character. So, okay. And then, of course, if I look for a character that is not in the text string, I get back a negative one here. I don't get an error. You will see in the chapter when you read it that there's an alternative index function as well, index method as well, that works just like the find method, but that would actually raise an error here. So sometimes the methods, they work, they behave a little bit different in some situations. But yeah, the find method gives us back a negative one to indicate that it didn't find a certain character. We can, of course, also look for entire substrings. So for example, I can check if a word is contained in a sentence. And then the 12 is just the index of the first occurrence. If I check for O, I get back 1. Why 1? Because in the second position, there is an O. However, let's say I want to find another O. How can I do that? I can pass it a second argument called start. It doesn't take the argument, so what does it take? Okay, so here is text again. Let's look at some other methods. Let's, for example, count. Count individual characters. So, for example, let's count how many L's are in the text. And the answer is 1. And this may surprise you, because there is, of course, an uppercase here, and there is a second letter L here. So there are actually 2 L characters in the text. And so it didn't find both of them. Why not? Well, because Python is case sensitive. So if I want to truly count all the L's, what I have to do is, and we saw this before, I have to lowercase the text, and then I can count for all the L's. I could also alternatively uppercase everything, of course. Okay, so let's look at another example to show something else that has to do with the fact that string types are immutable. So I create a new variable, example, which is the text random. And the text here is already lowercase, right? And now I go ahead and I call .lower on it to lowercase a text that is already lowercase. And I save the result in a variable called lower. And now the question is, are example and lower two different objects? And the answer is false. However, if I ask the question, are the two variables, are the two texts the same? Do they have the same content? The answer is true. And so here we see immutability basically at work. So whenever a method presumably changes the value of the text, what Python does, because the string type is immutable, it creates a new box. So what happened here in memory, maybe we can fit it here as well. So maybe if I draw here a text string with the word random in it, and I assign that to example, and if I now call the .lower method on it, what really happened is a second text string is created, which also has the same value, and the name is lower here. And we have a reference here as well. So that's to emphasize that whenever you call a method on a text string, and you know the text string will return a possibly modified version of the text string, it will always be a new object. And this is because the string type is immutable. So in other words, because we don't know if we have to really change a character, Python really always defaults to creating a new object, even though this would have been totally unnecessary here. You know, we could have had a reference here from lower to random, because that's the same. But here, again, string methods, they always return new objects. And this is due to the fact that possibly because the objects are just immutable, and in the case we would have to change the character, we are not allowed to do that. So this is why Python always gives us back a new object. Let's look at some other methods. So for example, a very common method is the split method. And what that does is it looks at the text string and it returns a list where it separates the individual words. So in this case, the split method uses whitespace to, so whitespace, and of course a single space character is whitespace, and it uses whitespace to separate the individual words, and then we end up with a list that consists of the individual words, and we see the dot belongs to the word to which it is attached, basically. And so what can we do with it? Well, oftentimes you have a big text string that consists maybe of many, many words. If you want to do, let's say, natural language processing of something, and you want to do to process every word in the sentence. So how can we do that? What can we do here? Well, we can use dot split, and we could technically loop over it. So here I simply show you that I put spaces, more space in between the individual words. This is just a toy example, of course, but you get the point. If I am given one big text string, like let's say one big document of text, and I want to do something with the individual words in it, the dot split method is a good way to get to the individual words. And there's the opposite method. Let's assume I'm given a list with those words in it. This will become a sentence. Then there is a join method that can join those individual words together. And how does it work? Because the join method must be used with a string. We have to create a string first to call the method on it. And then what this string is used for, it is used for as the delimiter to separate the words. So in other words, sentence now is one text string which consists of the individual words. If I put, let's say, a dash in here, and I do that again, then the words get glued together by the dash here. So let's go back and do it with just a simple space again. So join and split, they are sometimes very useful. And then a common mistake by beginners is they want to join together, let's say, a list of words, but then they accidentally forget, for example, the brackets of the list here. So if there were a list, this would basically do exactly what we did above. But if I join accidentally, for example, a text string, what I get is I get this. And why is that the case? Well, the join method, all it takes is an iterable of strings. Now, we have learned that a text string itself is an iterable. So if I pass in a list of strings, then the iterable whose elements will be joined together are the elements of the list. But if I accidentally pass in a text string to the join method, then the individual characters of the string get joined together. And this is usually not what we want. So, but that I just want to make you aware of a common beginner's mistake here. So let's look at some more methods that we can use. For example, there is a replace method. So a sentence, as we just created it, is just the sentence, this will become a sentence. And now that it is a sentence, I want to replace the will become with an is. And how do you do that? I use the replace method. So now I get back a new text string, of course, where the words will become are replaced by the one word is here. And then sentence. Yeah, and that's also important. In the upper cell, I called the replace method on the sentence object. And this gives me back an output here where it says this is a sentence, but because strings are immutable, the original sentence object is not changed. So that's also a reason why we do have a return value here. We will see in a future chapter that in some methods, in particular methods on mutable objects, will behave differently. But because the string is immutable, it always returns a new string, and it leaves the already existing object, in this case a sentence, untouched. It cannot touch it, right? It's forbidden. We cannot change it, an object that is immutable. Okay, then we have also seen before in chapter 4 when we processed some user input in the guessing a coin toss example, that sometimes it is quite valuable to use the dot strip method on a text, because let's say a user enters something and the user didn't see in this input prompt that he accidentally entered a space in the beginning or at the end. This often happens. Then we want to get rid of the spaces here. And how do we do that? With strip. So dot strip just gets away of the surrounding white space. And then there are two specialized methods, lstrip and rstrip, which only get rid of the white space of one of the two sides. But dot strip is commonly used when we have to deal with user input, and we have to make sure that the user input is somehow clean. And then we just strip away unnecessary white space. And then some utility method that you may find valuable when you build a program that prints out a lot of intermediate results. So for example, think that you do some calculations, and after every so-and-so many iterations of some big optimization you are running, you want to give out intermediate results, and you want to do that in a table. So in a table, usually the different columns, they are aligned as, you know, columns. So how can we do that with string data or with textual data here? Well, I can call the ljust method, for example, to left justify text. So what this does, it takes an argument 40, and 40 means the entire string will be 40 characters long, or 40 or more, but usually the number that is passed in is bigger than what we know the string will be like. The string will be, I don't know what this is, it's like 25 characters or so. And so if I want to left justify the sentence with 40 characters, what Python then does is it adds trailing white space, and this makes the entire string makes the entire string having 40 characters, and the spaces are just filled in, right? And we can also do right adjust, so we can put the entire text string to the right, and this is often done for numbers. So whenever you want to give out tabular data, and the tabular data consists of numbers, then numbers are usually right adjusted, so that you see that the decimals from the right, starting from the right, are always at the same position in a table, for example. I will actually show you an example of such an output later. So this is just to show you that these functions exist. And then, of course, there's another nice method that we can often use to especially work with numerical data. So let's say I have a float, 42.87, and I want to add as many zeros, leading zeros, to the left side, so that we have 10 digits displayed in total. You know that you cannot use leading zeros, because leading zeros are used as a prefix for the binary and the hexadecimal representations. So what we do here is I call cfill with number 10, and that gives me a total of 10 characters and leading zeros, such that the entire string is exactly 10 characters wide. And this is often also useful if you work with numerical data in a tabular form. So there is no reason for you, and I've seen this, to write write code that adds a certain number of spaces to some string manually, right? You can always just use those three methods, and those three methods are usually just fine in order to make strings ready for output in a table. And of course, we can also do that for negative numbers, and you see that it then leaves away one zero and uses that for the negative here, so that also the second version here only consists of 10 characters here. Okay, these were some common string methods. There are many, many more you will find in the documentation. And now let's look at some other syntactical area. Now we saw the methods, and now we look at what strings do when they are connected with operators. So for example, what happens if I take a slice, the first four characters of my lore ipsum text, and I add it to the string hello? So this may look weird for in the beginning. Can I add two strings? Because so far we have only seen two numbers being added. But of course I can also add two strings because the plus operator is overloaded to mean string concatenation. String concatenation is when we have two strings and we put them together. And then we get the string hello Laura. In the same way, we can also multiply a string. So here I multiply 5 with the first 12 characters in the text, which means lorem ipsum. So whenever you're in a situation where you have to fill in, let's say, dummy text with lorem ipsum, you only have to write lorem ipsum once, and you can just multiply it, and you get as many lorem ipsums as you want. And yeah, so it's also chained here. So we first do some multiplication, then we do the string concatenation here as well, the plus. But again, the operators work with strings. So the multiplication and the plus operators work. So the minus operator, of course, has no meaning. So the minus operator won't work for strings. It's not overloaded for strings, but plus and multiplication work. Okay, so another kind of operators that work with strings are comparison operators that we first saw in chapter 3. So for example, I can compare the string apple to the string banana. And what this does is it basically answers the question, does apple come before banana? Now, the problem is the characters, as we will see later in this chapter, they come in a weird ordering. But for now, if I execute this code cell, I get a true. And basically, this tells me that apple comes before banana in the alphabet. And why is that? Well, because the A comes before the B in the alphabet. And how is string comparison done? So what Python does is it does that in a pairwise fashion. So it takes the first character of the left operand, the A, compares it to the first operand of the first character of the second operand. And if they differ, then the sorting rules apply, and A comes before B. And because of that, the entire string apple comes before the string banana. So as long as, and we will see an example, as long as the letters are the same, then the decision cannot be made. So the first character that differs will basically make the decision. And then here's the thing that I just told you. What if I compare lowercase apple with uppercase banana? The problem here is, according to our alphabet, apple should still come before banana, but it doesn't. And so what you have to know is the comparison operators, they do take into account sorting or how the strings are sorted, just as if you were to compare the number 1 to the number 2, for example. If you asked, is 1 smaller than 2, then you will also compare the two orderings here. But it does it so in a different way. And the way will become clear towards the end of this chapter. But for now, no. You shouldn't compare strings where you know one string is uppercase and the other one is lowercase. An obvious solution to that is to always lowercase a string before comparing, right? Then apple still comes before banana. And now to see, to extend this, here are 5 German names. And I illustrate in this code cell several examples, basically. First, this is an example of operator chaining. So I can, of course, have more than one operator in a chain here. And this order is actually true. So if I execute the cell, I will get back a true. So that means my with AI is smaller than all of the 4 names here. And Meyer, the German last name, with AI is smaller than those three, and so on. So how do the rules that I just briefly mentioned above here work in detail? Well, the two strings here are compared, and here the first letters are the same, the second characters here are the same, and the third character is the same here on both sides. And then when one of the two operands is at its end, it's the shorter one, then the shorter one will be sorted before the longer one. So that's a rule. And then if we look here at the next two operands, so Maya, M and A, they are the same on both operands, but then the third character, the I, and the third character here, the Y, they differ, and because I comes before the Y, that's because Meyer comes before Maya with a Y here, and the same is true for the other two Meyers here. So this is how string comparison works. It works on a character by character basis, and the first two pair that differs is the decisive one. Okay, so now that was operators, and now we have another topic that is very easy, actually. So usually, when you write code with textual data and you want to prepare it for output, what you want to do is you want in your source code to write a string that basically looks like a template. And then whenever you load actual data into your program and process data, you want to fill in the template string with the actual data. So how can we do that in Python? So one way is to use the most modern version of this. It's called the fstrings, or format strings. How does it work? So let's say I have two variables called name and time of day, Alexander and morning. And now let's say I want to print out hello, the name, and then, you know, good time of the day. How can I do that? With a template. So what I do here is I prefix the string with an F. This is why the string is called an F string, but an F string is, syntactically speaking, also just a string. So it's nothing really different here. And then within curly braces, I just mention the expression that I want to be evaluated here. So I just reference the variable here, of course. And if I execute this, the string will say, hello, Alexander, good morning. And if I change the value of the, if I change the, you know, here Alexander to another name, then of course, if I execute the second code cell, I will have a different name here. So this is one way in which you can write a template string in your source code that will then be filled in with data coming from some other source. How can we do this for numbers? So let's say we have pi here to like 8 or 9 decimals. So what I can do here is I can, within the curly braces, write a colon and then a dot 2f. And the dot 2f basically means format this number or this variable with two decimals after the dot. That's what it means. And this is why I see the output pi is 3.14. And there is a so-called string format mini language that you can look up in the documentation. And there are many, many more options with which you can format your templates. And then you can write strings in your source code that look somewhat like this and parameterize the output. So the second way of doing this is the format method. So the format method is the most common one, I would say. And the fstring method we saw before is the newest one, and it's also the one that should be used going forward. But because the format method is also very common these days, we just quickly look at it. So how does this work? Well, I just write the string as a template, but I leave out the curly braces. So this is just like before. And then I say dot format, I call the method format on it. And then in the same order that those curly braces are to be filled in, I just pass in the variables. And I get back, hello, Alexander, good morning again. If I want to exchange the order, I can, of course, put indices in there. So here, it's, of course, zero-based indexing. So here, the name goes second. And this is what I can do to, you know, if the order will be a bit different. And then lastly, the format method also accepts keywords. So here I pass in the arguments with by position as positional arguments. And down here I pass in the two arguments by the keyword name and the keyword time. And the keyword name and time is written here in the curly braces again. And this is the third way of using the format method, and it also works. And then lastly, just to show you how you could also format a number, the colon dot 2f notation still works here for dot format called with a pi. So this is the second way. When you read code on the internet, most likely you will see the dot format method a lot, and this is all the ways in which you can use the format method. And then there's a third way, and it's actually an operator. It's the percent operator, which we understood to be the modulo operator for modulo division. But in the context of strings, the percentage operator is overloaded, and it's overloaded to do string formatting in a way. So what does this do? So here is, again, my sentence pi is, and then now we say percent sign dot 2f. So instead of colon dot 2f, we say percent sign dot 2f. But that percent is actually not the operator. So that's just the string. And then next to the string, we have the operator percent sign. And before that, we in the example of string concatenation, I had a plus before. So that's in the same, you know, syntactically the same as if I wrote a plus here. It's just an operator. And then I pass in the variable or the expression that I want to be filled in. And this also works. And that's the oldest way. This is the, I would call it the legacy way. Don't use this way going forward, but maybe you will still see it around on Stack Overflow when you ask some questions. And then, of course, you can extend this for more than one variable. And then all you need to do is you need to wrap the individual expressions that you want to pass in within parentheses. So the parentheses here are mandatory. And then here we write percentage s, and percentage s means that Python formats the values of those two variables here as strings, basically. But again, as I mentioned, those two cells, you shouldn't write cells like this on your own. I just mentioned this here because you will definitely find code like this on the internet when you look for answers to your questions on, for example, Stack Overflow. Okay, and now let's come to another topic, another big topic. And the question is, we have seen what strings are, and we have understood that strings are basically a collection of characters. And now I want to focus a little bit more on what is a character. So we want to really focus on an individual character right now. And how are characters modeled in memory, actually? So let's look at some examples. We have maybe seen before, I haven't talked about this, but actually, if you go back in the lecture here to the beginning of this chapter, you will actually see that at some of the strings that I showed you actually ended with a backslash n here. And now here in this string, we have several of those backslash n's in here. So what does the backslash n do? Well, if I evaluate this expression, it doesn't do anything. The only thing that happens is the double quotes will become single quotes, but the backslash n, which is in here, remains in here. I think you can already guess what the backslash n does. It stands, of course, for new line. And if I print out exactly this expression, what happens is the line breaks are actually shown. So the string itself, in the way it's represented, it only stores the backslash n as one character. So this is actually, even though we type it as two characters for Python, this counts as only one character. And when we print out the entire string, this character gets printed in the way that we are used to printing new lines, namely by going to a new line. And only when we use print, we see the effect here. So what is the backslash n here? Well, backslash is, again, the escape character. So whenever we see a backslash within a string, this means that the following letter or character will be interpreted in a different way, namely in a way that usually does something that we couldn't show otherwise. That usually it's a so-called unprintable character. So how would you print a new line up here, right? You couldn't do that. But if to express the idea of a new line, we use backslash n here. And in total, the backslash and the following character together, they are called or referred to as an escape character. Okay, let's look at some more. Backslash n is new line, and here I have backslash b. So what does backslash b do? Well, backslash b is a character that moves the cursor one to the left. So now I print out ABC, and then I move the cursor one to the left, and I print next character X. So what does that result in? Well, it results in an output ABX. So the C is gone. And the C is not really gone. The C was actually written, but then because we used the so-called backspace character, backslash B, we move back one space, and then we write over the C that existed, and we write an X. And this is why we only see the X. And so if you ever wondered if you used some tools in the terminal window, sometimes you know, the cursor does weird things or moves in a way that is kind of intuitive, then usually how the programmer does that is by using special characters, for example, like the backspace here. And so you can actually use that to move a cursor in an output in a terminal window. But we don't do this here. And then, of course, there is another one, backslash r. And this basically means we go back to the beginning of the line. So this is the line return or carriage return. That's what it's called. So when I want to print ABC and I go back to the beginning and I print X, I get XBC here. And in the same way, if I write XYC here and I run the cell again, the ABC is completely gone. So sometimes when you read in data from a file and the file contains the backslash R character, you may read in content that gets that does not get displayed or something. So you have to know that these kind of special characters, that they do exist. But they are definitely not part of day-to-day programming, I would say. One more example. This is maybe something that you can actually use. If you want to output some data in a tabular fashion, you can use backslash t, which is at the tab character. So we jump in tabs here. So here, as you can see here, between the words, we only have one character, right? It's not many spaces. We only have one character, the so-called tab character. And this may be useful, again, if you want to display some intermediate results of some long-running calculations that you do, and you want to do that in a nice tabular way, then maybe the tab character is helpful here. Okay, just a quick aside. Raw strings. So let's say I want to print out here the typical path of where on a Windows system an application is stored or installed. So let's say I want to print out C:\programs\new application. What happens? Well, unfortunately, I have a line break here because of the backslash n. And note that backslash p doesn't mean anything, so backslash p is okay, but the backslash n results in a line break. And we don't want that here, really, right? We want to print out the entire path to the file, but we don't want to have a line break. In the same way, let's say I want to print out some other path on a Windows system that lies under C users administrator and so on. Let's try to print this. And now I all of a sudden get an error. And why do I get an error? Well, I get an error because backslash u means that the following characters, and we will see an example soon, will be what is called a special Unicode character. And Python is not able to interpret the SERS that follows the backslash U as Unicode character. So because of that, it gives us actually a syntax error, as we see. So we don't want that. So what could you do if you really wanted to print out something that has a backslash N or backslash U in it? Well, what you could simply do is you could just escape all the backslashes. So all the backslashes, they become now two backslashes. And if I do that, then we get the output that we want. So that's one way. But there's another way, and this way is to prefix the double slash here, the double quote here with an R, and the R stands for raw, as in raw string. And what the R does is, it basically is an instruction to Python that whatever is inside the double quotes will be given out just as you typed it. So the backslash n will not be a new line character here, but it will just be backslash n. And in the same way, the backslash u here won't cause any troubles. We will just give out the path as we want it to. Okay, so now let's ask the question, what is a character? So we have seen characters in many ways. We have seen, most of the characters, they just work as if we type them on a keyboard. And then we have seen some special characters like the backslash n or some other escape characters. So escape characters, they have a special meaning when printed out. But what are characters? Okay, characters in a system called ASCII are nothing but numbers. So for example, the character uppercase A is somehow mapped to the number 65. So you may wonder, why is that the case? Well, you have to think like this. Just as an integer number, as we saw, is consisting of the individual zeros and ones of binaries, we go now one level higher, so we add one level of abstraction, so to say. And just as integer numbers are made up of individual bits, a character is now made up of individual numbers. So we just move one level higher here. And so you may wonder, why is it the number 65? Is there any reason for that? And the reason is that, well, in the early days, like in the 1960s, some people needed to standardize which number is mapped to which character. And many standards were created around the world. And the one that survived was the so-called ASCII standard. And ASCII is an American standard, so it only works for American letters or English letters. And in most or in many other countries around the world, other character sets or other ways of encoding were created. But then the question is, how do we, or what are the implications of that? So the implications is, if someone maps the number 65 to letter A and someone else uses another number to map to this letter, then if we transfer files between the two people, then whatever one person writes cannot be read by the other person because the letters, they just don't match up. So this has to be standardized. And the ASCII standard is the one that survives, obviously. And we can also go in the other way. So ORT and CHR character, these two functions are built-in functions that we can call. And the ORT function, we can give any character, any string. It must be an individual character. And then we are given back the integer number that this letter is mapped to. And the other way around, the character of 65, so the number 65 is mapped to the letter A. And then, of course, the special characters that we saw, like new line, they are also mapped to the number 10 here, and also vice versa. So all the characters that we have seen are indeed mapped to a single number, and it is standardized according to the ASCII standard. So what is the ASCII standard? So the ASCII standard works like this. The digits, and this is now an important distinction, the digits 0 to 9, that we know, they are mapped to the numbers 48 through 57. Now you may wonder, why is that? Well, there's a simple trick. So the trick is like this. We don't want to use as many bits as possible. So maybe what we would like, and I maybe go back here. So maybe we don't want to have a large number of bits to model individual characters. So let's say we want to only use 8 bits or 1 byte. Why do we want to do that? Well, we want to do that because otherwise we would maybe waste memory, right? Now the question is, how many characters can we model with 8 bits? And the answer is 8 bits or 1 byte. can express the numbers between 0 and 255. So we can express at most 255 different characters. And so in the early days, people had to like look, had to have like tables where they had to look up what an individual sequence of zeros and ones means in character-wise. So which number does it express and which character is it mapped to? And so the people in the early days, they were rather smart, or in other words, they were rather lazy. They didn't want to memorize a whole lot, so they tried to use some tricks. And one of the tricks is that the numbers 1 through 31, so the first 32 numbers, they are mapped to what is called control sequences. And what are typical control sequences? Well, for example, the new line. Or the backspace. You get the point. These are all characters that we don't see on the screen. However, they need to be mapped somehow. And so the people, they just map them to the first 32 bits, or first 32 integer numbers. And then, starting from the number 32 onwards, they wanted to be smart, and in particular, they wanted to be lazy. So why did they start, why did they map the digit 0 to the number 48? Well, if we look at here the binary representation of the number 48, then we see that the last four bits, they are all zeros, right? So because the last four bits are all zeros, we can basically read this as that's the number 0. And then the digit 2, the digit 1, is just the last four bits, we have 1. So this is exactly the same ones and zeros that we saw in chapter 5. And this goes on until the digit 9. And the digit 9 is, of course, the binary sequence 1001. So in other words, in order to express 10 different digits, you need at least 4 bits. So and then of course, what they did is they had to fit this into the system somehow. And because they made up that the first 32 characters are the control sequences, then they had to like find the first number that would basically allow a one-to-one translation of the bits here into real numbers. So that's why we started number 48 here. So in other words, the numbers 48 through 57 are mapped to the digits 0 through 9 because of this binary system. Okay. So here, again, it's just a simple for loop, and I print out the binary representation just to make this point. And this is just to show you of what is the reasoning behind. Let's take the next step. Now I want to show you the uppercase characters from A through Z. So the alphabet has 26 characters. So in other words, the character A will be the first character, right? And we already see where this is going. So if you look at the, I think it's the five, yeah, it's the five, the five least significant bits in the binary representation, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1. This is a one, in other words. This is, would be the number one as we learned it in chapter 5. And because this means the number one, we map it to the letter A because it's the first letter in the alphabet. And then the letter Z here, it's the 26th character in the alphabet, and the sequence 11010 is the number 26 in binary. So this is why the numbers 65 through 90, so 65 through 90, are mapped through to A through Z. And then one last step. And here you see for this, the small characters, the lowercase characters. And the only thing that is different between the lowercase characters and the uppercase characters is that we have, they are prefixed with two ones here, and the uppercase letters, they were prefixed with 10 here. But the 11 here only means that we just add a constant, basically, to the number. So we shift all the lowercase numbers one to the right, in a way. And then A is still the first letter of the alphabet, which means the five bits here are still the number one, and so on. And then note here how I used the rjust, the write just method to make the output nice. So the 79 here, the 98 here, and the 99 here is nicely adjusted to the write with the rjust method and a value of 3 here. So this is what I meant earlier when I said that the rjust and the leftjust and the cfill methods, they are commonly used to make tabular output in your program look nicer. And this is an example of that. Okay, so let me just write this down. The numbers 97 through 122. The set is omitted here because my output is a little bit shortened. Will be mapped to the letters A through Z lowercase. And now the question is, where do we put all the remaining symbols, like a dot, like a comma, the semicolon, and so on? Well, these are now put in the hole, so to say, of the system. So from numbers 32 through 47, we have symbols. I call it symbols 1 here. And then starting from 58, so 58 here through 100, what is it? Through 65 here, or 64. This is the second part of the symbols, symbol 2, and then we have more symbols here, and then more symbols here. So the special symbols, so the dot character and so on, they are just put in between the holes, so to say. And this is why I have the output here. And here I use rjust actually twice. So I adjust here first the number, the number that the symbol is mapped to. And then I also write adjust the binary representation, because as we see, the binary representation gets longer for the higher symbols as well. So this is a way to make the output look nice. So what's the learning of this? The learning of this is that the entire world now has its first 127 symbols, or 7 bits of information actually, mapped to the same characters. And they are standardized by, and it goes back to like some people being lazy and figuring out a smart way of doing this. But then the question is, what do we do with all the other characters? For example, I'm a native German speaker, so in Germany we have umlauts. If you go to Scandinavia, they also have special characters. If you go to Czech Republic, they also have special characters. Some countries, like China, for example, they have a language where they basically only consist of symbols that are not in the letters A through C. Although there is, of course, simplified Chinese, but the original Chinese does not, cannot be expressed by just 26 letters or, twice as many and so on. So what happened? Well, in the beginning, all these countries that had different languages, they had their own standards. And that is not good. And the reason why this is not good is because in a global world, you want to exchange information between all the nations and people that speak different languages. And we want to have a unified standard of how we can express text in a computer program. And the standard was invented in around the 90s. And in the early 90s, the first version of what is called Unicode was basically released. So what is Unicode? Unicode means that any character that ever existed in the history of humankind was assigned a number. And this number is called its code point. And the number is a number between some hexadecimal digits starting from 0 and going to around about 1 million. It's just over 1.1 million, actually. So that's the Unicode standard. So That's it, basically. Just as we had the numbers from 0 to 127 here mapped to the ASCII characters, we now have more than 1 million numbers mapped to more letters. And the Unicode standard by now contains all of the languages that are spoken around the world, plus more languages like Esperanto, for example, which used to be a language that was made up for everybody to learn. So we all speak this language. It never got popularized, but it still exists. Some of you know some science fiction movies, like, for example, Star Trek. And there is an alien race called the Klingons, and they also have a language, and this language is also in the Unicode standard because some nerds got it in. And of course, we also have other languages that we know. For example, mathematical symbols. So in math, we have our own notation. And these are all, and the notation in math, they are also considered characters, and they also are mapped to a unique Unicode code point. And because of that, we can express any character we want if only we know what is the code point. And in the chapter, you will find links to some of these tables. And for example, the smiley characters, the emoji characters, they are also mapped in Unicode. And here you see what a Unicode character is. We started with backslash u, that's an escape character. So backslash and uppercase u means that the following 8 digits are interpreted as hexadecimal. And this is why one of the reasons why I put a little bit more emphasis on hexadecimal in the last chapter. So even though it seems a bit awkward to study at first, for a data science practitioner, let's say if you want to work with textual data and we want to express letters other than the American letters, then we should at least know what hexadecimals are. And in some of the Unicode tables that you will find on the internet, you can look up a character, for example, the smiley character, and then the character will be mapped to exactly one number called the code point. And this number exists, of course, in decimal notation, but also in hexadecimal notation. And you need the hexadecimal notation in 8 characters or in 8 digits. And if you put this here, then we get a smiley. Luckily, all the Unicode characters also have a name by which they can be, by which they are uniquely known. For example, another smiley, which is called Face with Tears of Joy, is named Face with Tears of Joy, and we can use its name, put it in between curly braces, and precede that with a backslash n. And backslash n is also Unicode, but it means now we use the name. So if I evaluate this expression, I get back a different smiley here. So again, any character that has ever existed in the history of humankind is in the Unicode standard. You just have to find out either its name or its number. And then to go back to the normal characters, like for example the character A, we know that the character A is mapped to the number 65 in the ASCII standard, and the hexadecimal representation of 65 is just 0x41. And because we need 8 digits here, we have to write lots of leading zeros and then end with 41, backslash u in front of it. And because of that, we get back a unique letter that we could also type rather easy on the keyboard. But let's say we wouldn't have a keyboard here where we have an A on it, or the A key doesn't work. We can always write the key, the A letter like this. And whenever a Unicode character can be expressed in just 4 digits, what we could also do is we could just write backslash lowercase u and just put 4 digits, also 0041 here, to also get the A. And then for those letters that can be expressed with the numbers from 0 through 255, which means 1 byte of information, we can also just write backslash x for hexadecimal, or a byte basically, and then 41. So if I write this, this will also be an A. So at the end of the day, everything can be mapped, and depending on how high the code point number is, we either use the uppercase U or lowercase U or just the X. And also note that the first 127 symbols in the Unicode standard are identical to the ASCII code. So whenever you can express something in ASCII, then you could just as well type A. But ASCII as the predominant standard is just, you know, the smallest set within the Unicode standard. Okay, so what does that mean for the string type? Well, if I ask the question, how long is the letter A? How long is the text that contains only the letter A? The len function gives me back a 1. But now the question is, Let's say if I print a Unicode character snake, as in the Python snake, how long is that character? So if I call the len function with this character, I also get back one. So in other words, Python is smart enough to figure out that all these characters here, the backslash n and the snake here, that this basically means only one character. And at least it means to us as a human being, it means that this is only one character. That's the semantic meaning that is important. And the len function with the string type is aware of that. So the len function always gives us back the number of characters in the string and not the number of actual letters we had to write. In other words, Python is aware of Unicode and so on. Okay. Now that we have covered what is Unicode, let's quickly just cover how can you write in your source file text strings that are on more than one line of code. So, for example, you cannot do this, right? If I have a text string like this, it works. But if I want to, however, break this this text string into several lines in the source code, then I get a syntax error. I cannot do that. So there is a solution to that, and that is to just use triple quotes. So triple quotes, opening triple quotes here and closing triple quotes here, they work just as single quotes or single double quotes, I would say. However, within triple quotes, we can break the line. And what happens is the line breaks, they are stored in the string. And actually, just to illustrate this point, if I output multiline just as it is, then it's, of course, only one expression, and it was translated into backslash n, right? This is what this does here. So in other words, whenever we want to make our source code a little bit nicer, in particular, if you want to write text that goes beyond the 80 characters per line that we don't want to exceed, then you can always use triple quotes or triple double quotes, as they are called, and just break the line. It would also work with single quotes, so you could also use triple, let's do that, triple single quotes. 1, 2, 3. And this would also work, of course, but again, the convention in this book is that we use triple double quotes here. And this is a nice way to know. And of course, you may remember that for the functions we wrote, we always documented them with docstrings, and docstrings are nothing but normal Python strings just written with triple quotes, because the docstrings are usually written over several lines of code. And now I can do this. I can loop over the multiline string, and I can see that this string indeed consists of four lines of code. So you may wonder, why are there four? Well, we have a line break here, and then we have a line break here, we have a line break here. And if you have three line breaks, then you must have four lines, right? So this is something, so this is why the first and the last line is empty. We need to be careful with that. And how can you change that? Well, for example, by just adding the strip method here. If you add the strip method here, then what happens is the empty lines go away. So this is why you often will see the strip method in source code, especially when we use multiline strings. So this is just nothing new. So this does not allow us to do anything new. It just allows us to write the source code in a maybe nicer way. And now finally, this is the last section in this chapter today. We will talk about the bytes type. So what are bytes? Well, I already told you that in a computer, everything is ones and zeros. We call that bits. And groups of 8 ones and zeros are called one byte. And one byte is usually the unit of account in which computers communicate. So if I go on the internet, on the web browser, and I go to some website, then what happens is my laptop will send, will basically make a request to a web server, and this request is sent in pure bytes, so over the network. And along the way, all the routers on the way that make my request go to the web server, they also think in bytes. And then the web server, there it receives the bytes, and it has to, so to say, decode the bytes. So a byte is really only it's nothing fancy. It's just a collection of 8 bits, and it's just a unit of account. So just as sometimes if you're a large corporation, you report your balance sheet in millions of dollars or in millions of euros. You don't report them in just euro or dollar. So why do we do that? Because we're just used to having a larger unit of account for large corporations. And just as this is a unit of account, bytes are just a unit of account too. So let's see how bytes usually look like. So here I have a file, it's called fullhouse.bin, bin for binary, and I open it in my text editor on my laptop in Sublime Text. And when I open it, I see a weird thing. I see always groups of four and only some letters and some numbers. I don't really see any other information here. And now if we look closely, we will see that it's always the digits from 0 through 9 and the letters from A through F. So obviously, what we see here in this text file or in this text editor is hexadecimal notation. And hexadecimal, I told you, is just a nice way to express many bits because one hexadecimal has like the same expressive power as 4 bits. So we can basically have a shorter way of expressing the ones and zeros by just using hexadecimal notation. And now I want to open this file in Python. How do I do that? I use the open built-in, and I specify the path. And now I specify mode as RB. And R means I want to read this file only, and B means binary. So I'm basically telling Python, hey, I know that this file is not a text file. It's a file that consists of bytes. And I want to open this file. So now I open the binary file. And then what I do is, I call on the binary file here the .read method, and .read without a number specified will read the entire file. So what I can do here is I will just read the entire file and put it into a variable called data. So now let's look at data. What is data? Well, data is an object. It has a type, and the type is bytes. And now what's the value of data? The value is this. And if we go back to the text file or to the text editor, so the first two digits are basically F0 and 9F. And if I go back into Python, it is F0 and 9F here. And they are preceded with backslash X. And backslash S, X, we learned, is basically a special an escape character to indicate that the following two digits are hexadecimal. So this is now data that we got. And this could be data that we have sent over some network, and or this could be data that we got from basically opening an image file, for example. So a JPEG or other image files often only contain binary data. So we cannot, you cannot open a JPEG file or a MP3 file, for example, for sound data in a text editor. It doesn't work. And the reason is because image data and sound data is usually stored in bytes on disk. And if I read in such a file, I would see something similar to this. So I would just see the raw bytes that lie in this file. And now, whenever you are given just bytes, one way, well, you can actually look at it, you have to analyze it, and bytes, they are basically also a sequence, so they have a length. I can loop over the data stream here, so I can loop over the individual bytes. And note here that by looping over the individual bytes, they are given out as integers, and the integers are always between 0 and 255. So if I go back, the first digit here is the hexadecimal F0. So let's go ahead and check what is F0, so we just write it as hexadecimal, F0, and F0 is just the number 255 in hexadecimal, right? So, and by looping over the data, the bytes object, I obtain the individual bytes on a one-by-one basis, and an individual byte is nothing but a number between 0 and 255. And of course, I can index also from the end, so I can get the last byte, and the last byte is just the number 158, which would be the same as the hexadecimal 9e here. Okay, this is binary data, and I can also, of course, slice it. I can only take every other byte and so on. So it works just as if we had an ordinary string object, except that I cannot read characters here, right? So what can I do with that? Well, I told you that every character is mapped to an integer, to some number, and the standard to know here is the so-called Unicode standard. And then the question is, how are the numbers that I told you that the characters are mapped to, how are they stored on disk? Well, they are basically stored in bytes, so that's why I have the bytes section here. And then whenever I have the raw bytes on disk, I have to like decode them into numbers. So here again, we have the numbers that are mapped to some characters. And basically on this side, we would have the individual bytes that are mapped to some numbers, or they are encoded, basically. So in other words, the numbers that are here, they are in the bytes somehow. So how do we get to the numbers? Well, we can always try to decode the data. So whenever we have a bytes object, we just decode it with the decode method. And then we will see that what we get back, I store it in a variable called cards, what we get back is a string. So in other words, Python was able to decode the stream of bytes into a text string, and it seems to be like a deck of cards here, or let's say five cards that resemble what is called a full house. So that's why the file is called fullhouse.bin, because it contains the characters, the Unicode characters that make up those five cards here. So what did we learn here? Well, I only want to make you aware that the bytes format is a very generic way of exchanging data. And if you want to go into data science, you will one way or the other encounter data that is stored in a bytes format. Most notably, of course, binary data would be images or video files or audio files. And then we have to decode bytes into usually numbers. And when we know that the bytes that we are given is actually textual data, and then we can try to decode it into, let's say, the Unicode numbers. And once we get them back to Unicode numbers, we can immediately tell which character they are. Okay. And we can also go the other way. So let's say I have a place where I want to drink coffee, which is called Café Kastanientörtchen. This really exists, by the way. And let's say I want to go the other way and make the text string a byte object. I can, of course, call the .encode method on the string, and I get back the following sequence of bytes. And what I see here is the following. The first three characters, which are C, A, and F, which are characters that are in the ASCII set, they are just encoded with themselves in a way. So it just says C, A, F here. And then the E with the apostrophe on it is encoded as two hexadecimals. And this is true because, as I told you, all the ASCII characters, they can be expressed with numbers from 1 through 127, which means 7 bits of information, or 8 bit if we just give it one more bit. And that means every character that is an ASCII character can be expressed basically as itself. But then all the other Unicode characters that cannot be expressed with one byte of information, that they must be stored on disk in more than one byte. And in particular, the E with the apostrophe on it is stored as 2 bytes of data. And this is how a computer thinks of it. So for a computer, the letters A through Z in the American alphabet, they are usually stored with 8 bits, and other letters are usually stored with more than 8 bits, in particular, in this case, with 16 bits or 2 bytes. So why would that be important? Well, oftentimes, still to this day, you are given data that is not encoded with Unicode. or some standard or some encoding called UTF-8, actually. So, for example, maybe you have heard of this standard here. Let's say I encode place with this other encoding here. I get back a different result, and the letters A through F, A through Z, are encoded in the same way as before, and just the German umlauts here, the Ö and so on, they are encoded in a different way, and you have to basically know the encoding that was used of the bytes data. Otherwise, you cannot really make sense of the bytes. And the default encoding that we use is the UTF-8 encoding, which goes along with the Unicode standard. And one remark here as well. So whenever we encode something with a given standard, then we also have to decode it with the same encoding. So for example, if I leave out the argument to the decode, this is as if I set UTF-8 here, and I get, of course, an error here. But if I decode the encoded bytes with the same encoding, it always works. So I get back here the correct letters here, okay? And let's do the error again. And then, of course, some of the letters cannot be encoded with a certain encoding. So, for example, this here is the Czech language, and the Czech language also has some special characters, and I try to encode it with the ISO standard here, with the ISO 88591 standard, and ISO 88591 here is the Western European standard, and because the Czech language is not considered a Western European language, we will get an encode error here. So up here, note we have a decode error, and down here we have an encode error. So because that means that those special characters in the Czech language cannot be encoded with this encoding here. So I didn't go into too much detail here with encodings because that is something that we don't want to deal with. However, sometimes we get files that are encoded in an encoding that is other than the so-called UTF-8 encoding. And so what does that mean? So let's look at an example. Let's look at the example, a file called umlauts.txt. I open this in my text editor, and I open this file, and it seems as if something went wrong here because I have many question marks in here, right? And of course, there is something going wrong here. So if I open the file umlauts.txt, I get a decode error. So we cannot really open the file. And the reason is because we chose the wrong encoding. And usually, this means we have to ask the person that sent us a file, what did you encode the file with? And if we know the correct encoding, you can specify encoding in the open function. And then all of a sudden, it works. And then we see that now this is all the German umlauts that got lost in the version before. And now we can read it. So, but just by knowing the correct encoding. Okay, and the best practice is to use an encoding called UTF-8. And this is basically the encoding that gets used anyways if we don't specify it. But the best practice is to always specify the encoding to UTF-8 because that is the encoding that is most commonly used. And this encoding has the property that it can actually encode all the Unicode characters. So we have seen before with the Czech language and also the German umlauts that some encodings, they cannot deal with all the letters. But the UTF-8 encoding can actually deal with all the letters. And that is why we should usually use that if we can. And if we are given data that doesn't work with that, maybe we should first ask the source that gives us the data maybe to encode data with UTF-8 because that makes life a lot easier. And here, this is to finish the chapter today. We have here many things together at once. So let's say I go back to my original example of the lorem ipsum text file. And I want to read in the entire contents into one variable. This is often what you want to do, right? You want to open a file and read in all contents into one variable. How do you do that? Well, first, we always do that with the context manager to make sure that the file always gets closed. And then the best practice is, as I said, to always specify encoding is equal to UTF-8. On Linux and Mac machines, this shouldn't make a difference. But oftentimes, when you run this code on a Windows machine and don't specify an encoding, things can go wrong. And this is due to the fact that Windows tries to make guesses about a file's encoding in a different way. So always better to always specify the encoding explicitly. And then what we do is, here I use the join method that we saw earlier, and I use the read lines plural here method on the file object to read in the entire file at once. So we need to be careful here. This only works if the file is not too big, if the file's contents actually fit into memory. And then I join the entire strings, because read lines returns me a list of strings. And then I join all the strings together into one string, and I store it in a variable called content. And then I can, for example, print out the content. And note that the new lines are respected here, right? So the new lines still are here. And I can also, if I just look at what would be content if I don't print it out, it would be just one string with all the new line characters in it. So this is just what the string would look like. And of course, because it's very long, we cannot really look at it. And it makes more sense to use the print function. Okay, so I want to quickly wrap up this lecture. So what did we see here? What are the takeaways? Well, we saw that the string type is the default way of modeling text in Python. That's always what you should use. We saw that strings are sequences, and we will talk about sequences in Chapter 7 very extensively. And what are sequences? These are any types in Python that have four properties. The four properties are that they are finite, so they have a limited number of things in it, and the things here are the characters. We can loop over them, that means they are iterable. We can loop over them in order, or also in reverse order. And and they are containers, so they contain other things. And the things that a string contains are the individual characters, of course. So that's about strings. So and then because of all of that, we can do nice things with strings, like indexing and slicing. We have many string methods. We learned that every character in a string is a Unicode character. That's important, because that means we can basically write anything we want that in any character from any language in the history of humankind. The downside of this is that the more letters we use that are not in ASCII, when we want to save them somewhere on disk, for example, they have to be encoded. And the encoding happens in the same way as the stir object is encoded into a bytes object. And the bytes object is basically one way to model data that we do get in an unencoded way. So this is the standard that is used on the web. And then once we decoded the bytes and we are given a string, then we can just work with the string in terms of just characters. And this is a level of abstraction that is nice for us as data scientists, because as data scientists, we don't want to work with the bytes too much, but we should still know a little bit of how bytes work. And then what else have we seen? We have seen, of course, how to open files. I think that's a valuable thing to know. Always make sure that you use the context manager here. We have not seen how to store files or how to write to files. That's also very easy to do, however. You will find many tutorials on that on the internet as well. And I think this is it. And then see you soon.